So we talk here about the first module, and that was introduction to AI on Azure. In this, we discussed here about introduction to artificial intelligence. We understood about the different technologies there that we are already working on, like we are talking here about the kind of visual perception, text analytics, speech, and decision making. And before that, we were talking about the basic concept, what exactly intelligence, what is the meaning of artificial intelligence, and the different capabilities by this. Thereafter, we discussed about the difference between these terminologies that are having the different definitions in the market, data science, machine learning, and AI. Then for the implementation, we discussed about the basic understanding. You don't need to worry about the programming language. You can go with anyone. The different SDKs are there. We discussed about for consuming REST and SDK. We understood about this. We discussed something about the DevOps, the basic things. These are inbuilt there. With that, when we are going to implement or we are going to develop a model there, so we must have the basic understanding of machine learning, model training, probability and confidence score, and with that, one important thing, responsible AI. You will be watching the various questions from this topic that we discussed yesterday. So that was fairness, liability and safety, privacy and security, inclusiveness, transparency, and accountability. So these six principles are important because you will get the various questions on this. And then after, we discussed how exactly we can implement in Azure. For that, we discussed about the various services. So can you help me with this? One, I can see Azure Machine Learning. Instead of that, we had a few more. What was that? Remember?
I know one was notebook, maybe automated machine learning. And then there was a third one I can't really remember. Christian, you remember that one?
Okay. So we had the various tools here in this. Yes, definitely. It was designer as well as one was AutoML that we discussed. But for that, we discussed especially for this service, Azure Machine Learning, we discussed about the data. We had the data set. We had the experiment for this. For holding the models, model page was there. For endpoints, we had endpoints. So basically, we were discussing if we want to do anything, any workload related to machine learning, these all things we can do under Azure Machine Learning Studio. So this was one thing. And after that, we discussed some more services for the different tasks. Those services were means we were talking about some extra services that we required. This is something we discussed about the machine learning. You will provide the data to the algorithm, and then after you will make the model. In between, you have the various workload that we can do on this service. It's okay. But for developing those AI solution, for example, I want to go with computer vision, right? I want to go with the text analytics.
Yeah.
Right? For that, I need any specific service. What was the name of this?
The cognitive service. The cognitive.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Yes. Yes. You are absolutely right. It was cognitive service. And for example, I want to make the boat. For the boat, any service? Remember that thing? One service for the boat, we had the Azure boat service. Right?
Yeah. Yes.
And one more service. That one is a cognitive service under which if I want to go with, as I'm saying about the computer vision, I want to go with text analytics, I want to go for speech, I want to go for decision. For all of these things, we can go with cognitive service. So various tasks are there. We will be implementing everything one by one. We will be watching each and everything there. And then after I discuss about the board service, one more is cognitive search. This service will be used for making the search a solution. So basically, these services are there that we can use for developing different workload, different solutions related to AI. One is cognitive service, one is cognitive search. Right. So basically, we just need to remember this part. We have the search, we have the board service, we have cognitive service. Under this service, we have the various subservices are there that we can see. And we can remember this part, this language, speech, vision, decision. So today we will start it with the first one, where we will talk about the text analytics and the different things here. One by one, we will be moving in this. We will be talking about the speech. This comes under the NLP. So NLP refers to natural language processing. So we will be talking about those basic things, like whenever we want to interact with machine by saying something, by speaking something, or by writing something. I'm talking about text and speech. Related to this, we will talk about. But this was something that we discussed some in the first module. Then in the second module, we were talking about the developing your AI application with cognitive service. So one thing that we need to remember, we were discussing about some general cognitive service and standalone. Can you elaborate that thing? What was the meaning of that? Remember that thing? Like we discussed about a general cognitive service and one is standalone.
So basically, you have the option to implement one service, or you can implement
the multi.
Multiple.
And,
yeah.
You know, you'll do that either, you know, based on maybe separating pricing or, you know, some other reason.
Yes, exactly. Like if I want to bring all the services together under the one umbrella, I can go with this general cognitive service. It contains the multi-services. As I was showing you in the previous slide, like where I was showing you the language, vision, speech, decision-making, those all different kind of tasks I can do under this single API that will be under by the cognitive service. So this is multi-service resource. And you say, I don't want to go with this all the services. I would like to use only the single one text analytics. I can call it standalone or the single service resource. Right, so it comes with the both the ways. It will be depending upon our requirement. My requirement is that I want to use multiple things under with the single API, as we were doing yesterday. So I was just taking the cognitive service and I was doing all the text analytics tasks. I could do the form recognizer. I could do the text analytics. All the tasks I could do with a single API. Right? Remember that thing? We were talking about the portal. Where is my portal? All right, so it's open there. So there we can see I had my cognitive service with me. With this name, my cognitive service. And there I could see my credentials under this keys and endpoint. I could see my keys and location and endpoint. I use this one by using the single endpoint. I could use this one for the different tasks. And out of them, it is multi-service resource, including the different services under the single API. Either I could go with the single one, text analytics. I could go into the portal, could make this service like text analytics only. That could be. So I want to give the pay for only this service, not for all. It will be depending. So we discussed about this part. We discussed about the endpoint keys and location that we can get here after creating or after developing your deploying your service. Then after we discussed about the cognitive service REST API. We saw that thing practically where we were providing the things like we had like we were creating the headers or URI, and then after we were making the connection just by providing them. And then after once you were creating the connection, you were using the language. This was one way. The second way was SDK. This was the easier one. We created the client. If you remember, we created the client, and after creating the client, we were talking about the method. So in most of the cases, you will see this basic syntax. So different clients are there, different tasks are there. For each task, we have the different client classes are there. So in most of the cases, you will see, like you are going to create the X refers to, it can be anything. It can be text analytics. It can be form recognizer. It can be my, custom vision client. So we may have the different clients here, in which you will provide the endpoint and key, and you will get the client. And over this client, you will apply the method. For example, yesterday we did a text analytics client. And after creating the client, we were making this method detect_language. That was my method name. And I was providing the text. It was detecting the language. It was a simple thing. You can see at the bottom there, text analytics client. We will provide the endpoint and key. We will get the client. And we will say client.detect_language. This is some story that we will be watching in almost all the cases, but this was a general thing that we did by using SDK. So in the SDK, we will be using the different language SDK, So as we discussed yesterday, we were proceeding with the Python language, right? And this, again, you will do the request and you will get the response. So why we are discussing this part? So you may have the different scenario-based questions also. So in, at that time, you could be able to give these answers easily. So there you need to remember one point part, REST APIs and SDK. And we saw these things in the practical as well. As I'm discussing about the REST, you will create the and URI body as well as header, and then after you will make the connection and you will get the response. While in this case, you will ask to client, hey client, detect underscore language, client.detect underscore language. By using the method, you will be getting the response back. But before using these things, you need your credentials of Koenig service. So first you need to create the Koenig service as I was showing you there. I created this, I provided this keys and endpoint, and I could use these things in the REST API and the SDK. And then in the second lesson, we discussed here about the security. Mainly we were talking about something, this box. So can you help me with this? What was that?
The key vault.
Yeah, exactly. So how exactly it worked? Means what we did in this lab as well. Like in the lab, we were watching something managing the authorization keys. And then after second was to access with the key vault. Can you a little bit elaborate? I will be expecting this thing from you guys because you did that practice well, and that will be good practice for you as well for the remembering the things. Yes, please. If any can one can tell me about this part.
Okay. You know, it's good practice based on your security practice to regenerate the keys regularly, and
yep.
So if you implement that, then you should, do so in a specific way in order to not lock yourself out or prevent access to the application. So you mentioned that it's probably best to, if you're going to regenerate the keys based on your cycle, to change it, your current keys to the second key, then regenerate. And then once the keys are regenerated, then switch back to the key one.
Yep, exactly. So we did it. How can we do this? Means how we can generate the keys? Remember that thing? For generating the keys there, if I want this keys, like I can see this keys, how can I regenerate?
There's a button above that says regenerate key one and two.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Any other way through which we can regenerate the keys?
Yeah, through the CLI. I'm trying to think if it's the CLI. Okay, yep.
Yes, command line interface. By that also, we can do this. Yes, this was the first part where we were talking about regenerating keys. And as you were saying very well, you remember that part, we were talking about the production application and we want to switch to the key two, and then after we will regenerate the key one. Exactly. While in the second case, we were talking about the key vault. Would like to say something about this? So this was key vault that we were using.
Yes. I can't remember under the specific use case again, but it appeared that if you were maybe connecting to an on-prem a solution, you would set up your container, or maybe I'm getting that wrong. I believe.
Container is that was the next portion, but okay. In this we were talking about the keys, like we were storing in the secret. We did the practical, in which we were storing the key. If you remember.
I think it's a little bit fuzzy for me. I'll either back out or allow Christian to take over.
Christian, would you like to speak something about this? You remember something about this?
Okay, basic.
No issue. If you, I just explained that. No worry. But remember that thing. Like in this, because this will be a good practice. Like when you will be going for these kind of things, so it will be good. Like in the exam as well. So this is the important topic. And you will be getting the at least one question on this topic. That's why I was specifying this key vault. So remember that, like in this key vault, we can just specify the different keys. And we were doing the same part, like we created the key vault. I just show you first. There we have the key vault. And in the key vault, we were storing the keys in the secret.
Yes.
We were going there, right?
Yeah, and all this, yes.
Yes, we were giving some name, and then after the value that we were giving, it was my key. That was my cognitive service key, right? So maybe that's it. I need to copy it from there. And then after we created this, we can see this key here. There I have my key. I added this one with the name my key, and the name, the key is there. Current version that is showing. So basically what it means, like we were trying to just to hold the keys inside this key vault. And if I want to access that, we could use a service principal ID.